Welcome in YouTube. Thanks for joining us today. This is for everyone who has probably either never welded a day in their life before, or maybe they've been welding a little bit, but have never stick welded. I'm gonna cut out a little bit of the frustration right off the top in this episode. Now again, guys, this video is for the newbies that are just getting into this welding process for the first time. From the outside looking in, it's just simply putting a little stick rod in this little doohickey. They touch metal and it makes weld. But then right when you're first learning, it's probably the hardest thing to pick up, because just simply striking an arc and getting a bead started is probably one of the hardest things about the process. Once you get that out of the way, it's just about mattering of honing in that puddle. And I don't think it's very fair to y'all to just jump into the demonstration. I'd like to do a little bit of theory for everything that I do here on the channel. You do not need to know any of the stuff I'm about to go over in order to touch metal and make a puddle and make a weld. However, I do think it's valuable because it will explain a lot of the whys you're having such frustrations. First, looking at just getting set up. We've got our machine, got some amperage, we've got some plugs to plug in. We need to know what polarity we need to run for this stick welding process. Same thing with the amperage we need to run. If we have our amps too cold, it's gonna be easy to stick our rod. If we are supposed to be running DC positive polarity and we have that backwards, it might be a little bit more frustrating. You might have some rod stickage to happen. If you have your rod diameter, again, is bigger than the amps you're using, you're probably gonna have some rod stickage. If you got a really thick piece of work, even if it's super duper cold outside, I know it even might sound silly, but a cold piece of work could make it a little bit harder to get going. All of this kind of focuses on this guy right here. That welding electrode. But as far as SMAW electrodes, they have the numbers, they have the classifications. We should know by now, if we're in welding school, that those first two numbers are our tensile strength. We're going through our weld position at this point, and then our chemical composition and the makeup of the flux on that welding rod. We'll also tell you what polarity to run it. You don't have to guess. There is information already on everything that'll tell you. Even on this rod specifically, it has plus, 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 plus. That means running on DC positive. Really, when it comes down to it, guys, believe it or not, this rod is the same as a 7018 right here on that core wire. This core wire is pretty much made out of mild steel, low carbon steel, and that it goes for a lot of carbon and carbon alloys. Where all the good stuff comes from and makes these rods so different is the flux that's around them. We have cellulose type rods, rutile, iron oxide, low hydrogen, and then a couple examples of each ones. There are so many different types of stick welding electrodes out there, and we're not even getting into the different types of alloys of carbon steels, low, high, medium, different stainless steels and aluminum. I mean, so many different types of stick welding electrodes. This is only scratching the surface. Rutile rods are your general purpose electrodes and strike up, oh my gosh, so easy. You don't even have to try. Whereas these cellulose rods could be a little bit more stubborn, and with the low hydrogens even being a little bit more tricky. Whew. So with all these rods being a little bit different than each other, they run a little bit different. And even it comes back to the welding machine, how it wants to weld. Let's go look at that. Now for today's demonstration, we're gonna be using the ESAB Renegade Volt. Yeah, this is a battery powered welder. However, if you don't need the batteries, you don't need them. I really wish more people saw the videos that we created last year in 2024, where we took this same welding machine and we put it on a snowmobile, took it in the backcountry of Colorado, just covered the freaking thing in snow, and it still worked to make the repair that we were heading to, as well as snowboarding down a mountain. That one was a little silly, but we got to the job and we made the welds on site with the batteries. I'm not gonna be using the batteries. I got them unplugged right now. I got it plugged in right into the wall. That's what I really like about this, is you don't necessarily need the batteries, but you can run it straight off the plug. Getting into it though, the reason why I wanted to show more of this is because when we go to the process here and we pick stick and we come all the way over to our electrodes, it has a specific function on this machine. 6010s and 6011s, they can be tough to run. This one has a specific button, so you can click a cellulose rod, as we're gonna be using a 6010 today, as well as we're gonna be using our basic 7018s. It has two different settings for that, aside from the amperage. Now, we even have to set our amperage properly, of course. When I'm using a 1/8 diameter 7018, I like to be somewhere around 120 amps. If I'm using a 1/8 diameter 6010, however, same size wire, but because that flux is different, I'm gonna actually run probably closer to, that's the wrong direction, cowboy, in between 80 and 90, somewhere at that point. And even still, that might be a little bit aggressive depending on the thickness of base mill. We're running about 1/4 inch plate today, so we don't need to be super hot with our 6010s. Some other things that can help prevent from sticking that this machine can offer is, of course, your arc force, which, depending on the electrode, it kind of gives a crisp or soft feeling to it. If you get into it, you'll understand it's a little bit more violent on the crisp side and on the soft side of stuff. If you take away that arc force, it tends to be harder to run sometimes. But if you have an aggressive arc, it's nice to soften it. So sometimes if you're too soft, you might end up having a hard time keeping a rod lit. So depending on what rod you're running, you might want to adjust that arc force. And same thing with our hot start. Hot start's super nice as far as a function to keep you from sticking right off the jump. I usually set it right there at about 5, right in the middle, kind of like a percentage. So it's going to give you like 50% of the amperage you set for a certain amount of time. We're going to start with our 6010s first because I think they're a little bit easier to light. So we'll go back there, go back. We got our amperage set. We're going to set that sucker to 85. Now, like I said, we're going to be doing some beginner stuff today. These are really beginner techniques. And I'll give a shout out to my good buddy from the Great White North, Guy Segay. Guys, go check him out, Sewing with Fire, over there on Instagram and TikTok. He does some really good stuff up there with his students in Canada. And something that I don't see very often here in the States is what he likes to teach his classes, just starting with stick welding, no matter what electrode they have. He takes this piece of plate, just as I have here. It's a 6x6 piece of quarter inch piece of plate. And we've go ahead and taken a scribe and a punch and a hammer, laid it out with a square. We've got our scribe marks basically making a grid. Then we go about putting punch marks on all those intersecting lines. And now we have a bunch of individual spots that we can practice lighting up an electrode and getting a puddle started. That's it, guys. We're not doing anything else today. If you can get a puddle going, then we can move on with those straight beads. The other things that you got to be aware of being a complete newbie is you are going to burn yourself if you are not careful. So get the right gear. Same thing with your electrodes as they sit on the sides and stuff. You want to keep your electrodes protected too. You don't want to set them on your welding table where they're going to get spatter and stuff. I like to keep them in my pockets here on these Area FR pants. It got what I call a little quiver pocket. Keeps that flux from chipping off because that makes it a whole nother issue. We'll get into that. FR clothing is great. There's so many different brands out there. I stick with what I know since middle school, and that's Ariat. So I'm head to toe Ariat most of the time. Same thing with a thick pair of stick gloves. A lot of newbies are grabbing that plate. They're moving that plate around. They're grabbing that stick rod as it gets stuck, and they're just ruining their gloves. It's hot, guys. Do not touch it. Fajita, hot plate, just like at the restaurant. With your welding hoods, you're new. I understand it. Shade 10. Let's get the shade to a 10 minimum for stick welding. Let's get that sensitivity up. And an auto dark hood, a nice auto dark hood is always nice to have. Make sure that you change the batteries. And I had to change the batteries in this one after about 2 years, but that's not too shabby. We got everything we need to get started. Let's go to exactly what we're going to be doing on this piece of plate. Always, always, always just try to find yourself in a way to be comfortable. Now I'm sitting down. I really honestly hated seeing my students be sitting down in class. You should get in a good habit of standing up because it's not often that you're going to be able to sit down and stick weld, but get comfortable. That's the biggest thing, right? So I've got my ground unhooked. I want to make sure that I have full control. I don't want to be floating out here in space. I want full control over what I'm doing. I don't need to be directly over top of it. I want to actually try to practice this if I was trying to run a bead from left to right. So I'm going to have that 10 or 15 degrees of a travel angle and trying to keep in line with all these dots, but I'm not going to go any further. I'm going to be trying to just strike up right on that dot. We're going to be going about a dime size puddle and then we're going to stop. You'll see people try to tap and try to do the strike the match thing. If you're gonna tap, make sure your part is like at least clamped. If you don't have a clamp on your part, you're probably gonna be just throwing it all over the table. And it also helps with some grounding too. Whether you wanna put a tack on the table or whatever, that's fine. Just keep the plate secure and grind off your tack later for the next person. Be that type of person, right? People go and they just get crazy with it. They just start tapping and tapping and tapping that electrode. And they're not even paying attention to the fact they've already got that sucker lit, but by the time they realize it, they're already back on that plate and they stick the rod or they snuff out the arc that they started. We're trying to light up an arc and maintain something about a quarter of an inch to get things going. If we go past that quarter of an inch, the arc goes off, right? Same thing with the striking the match method. If you sit there and try to strike it like a match and you come up too far away, you've lit it and you've turned it off again, lit it and turned it off again. Try to be a little bit more predictable about it and finesse that arc strike in order to get it going. The more times you stick that rod and the nastier it gets on the end of it, it's gonna be harder to light. So you're gonna need to do something, whether it's clean the tip of the electrode off, tap it off, get that core wire exposed, clean up the plate, wire wheel it, grind it, whatever you have to do in order to get things back to normal again. But that's what we're gonna be doing today. First off with the 6010, we're gonna make a start, stop, start, stop, relight, relight. So we're going to start with the 6010 rod. I've even put the electrode at the 45 down, being that I'm working in the flat position so I can hold all my angles without having to hold my elbow all the way up like that. So here we go. We're just going to strike an arc, make a puddle about the size of a dime, and let go. Strike an arc, size of a dime, let go. Strike an arc, size of a dime, let go. Now I want you guys to pay close attention. I'm starting right next to my dot, and when I go to swipe next to it, I barely have to touch that material. I know where that clean spot on that electrode is, and I only need to make that quick little swipe.
But I'm not flicking. I'm not flicking up and away. I'm barely grazing the surface, and then I'm only a quarter of an inch max away to get that started.
I'm gonna do the exact same thing with this rod. Oh wait, where are my safety glasses? I do want you to see where I'm sitting my tip of my electrode. All right. See where I'm sitting next to that hole? Graze. And honestly, the fact that this electrode is burning away from me, I almost don't have to hold it a certain distance, because as soon as that light initiates, I want to hold my hands where they're at.
Because that rod is burning away, it's already getting the distance between the two pieces, the electrode and the work, and I honestly need to start keeping up with it. But I cannot push in too quick to get that bead going, because then I'll stick that rod again. If the puddle is started, it is established, we get it to this point, it should be hot enough that we can start to even touch that puddle without sticking.
If I strike up and dive in, stick. Every time. If I strike up and immediately try to get back in, I stick.
You gotta let that rod establish a puddle first.
So if all I gotta do is light up, wait a second, get that puddle there, then look. I can stab into that sucker as much as I want. It's hot, it's molten, it's gonna keep the rod alive.
Let's try some 7018s. Now, remember how I said that all rods are kind of the same but different because of the flux that's on the outside. This really doesn't change my technique at all as far as trying to keep that rod as close to that material and just barely touching it and keeping that lift just as gentle as I can possibly keep it. The only change is how that flux will react to that burn, how quick it forms that puddle, how fast you can get started, or restarting and relighting a lot. A rod can be trickier. Like these 7018s, for example.
As we go to do the same technique, we've got our amperage turned up to 120 amps minimum is what I like a 1/8 at. We're gonna do the same thing. You can see that that puddle is a little bit more flexy. It's got a little bit more flux
and iron powder in this type of electrode. So it takes some time to get there. And then once it's done, it forms this little slag kind of encasing over the tip of the electrode, which sometimes
we'll see, just like that.
We can't light that rod. That's where everyone starts to get into that crazy tap thing, or they start tapping it on the table. You can most certainly do that. But my suggestion is just to give it that little bit extra tap to get it lit. Once you see that it can light, then go back for that. I don't try to beat it on the table or brush it or try to do anything on the end of that that could damage the rest of the flux.
So all we're gonna do is tap a little harder. You can see that it lights. We'll break off. We got things showing, no damage to the end as much, and we can go back to that technique.
One other thing you can do, if you can strike up fast enough, if that rod tip is still glowing, it usually will light up a lot faster too.
Now, that's not always common, but like I said, we can get that puddle started, and we can come up, come back down, and you've got that rod just still hot. It hasn't made that
hard, glassy deposit, that slag to cover the tip of that core that you're trying to do so that you can get right back in there. You'll notice that it wants to grab a lot harder too.
As we go to tap it,
that sucker is stuck. Simply snap the wrist.
Snap your wrist off, like that.
Don't go crazy. And if it doesn't snap, calmly let go of the back of the electrode and wiggle it off. Now remember, guys, the whole point of this exercise is to get your fundamentals together. You gotta have those fundamentals before you can strike up and get the fundamentals of getting a straight bead. If you haven't seen it already, we've got a great video on how to run a straight bead right after this. This is awesome for someone who's just starting and is getting frustrated. Get you one of these plates out. The whole point of the grid is to have the right aim. You're supposed to be doing it in a specific spot, so make sure you have a specific spot to aim for. We shouldn't be doing this willy-nilly all over the plate. Same thing with the size of the little puddle you're trying to make. You should try to be consistent with the same size nugget that you're leaving down, because that's the same size as the rest of the weld you're gonna continue to do as you progress from making these dots to making straight welds and so on and so forth. Be sure to go check out the links down below in the description from our partners like Ariat and ESOB. They help us get a lot of the content done just as you guys do for watching. We really appreciate it. We'll see you guys on the next weld. Because it will explain a lot of the whys you're having such frustrations. For example, where'd my marker go? Oh man, lose my head if it wasn't attached to my hair dose.